Well, in South Africa, when I was there starting in 1998, they had three stations. So one of their cameramen happened to be in my class. And so I was doing kind of the history of American labor and Canadian labor, American and Canadian labor law. And this shop steward raises his hand, and he looks at me and he goes, "John, I don't get it. How is it that America, that is so strong, a nation, can treat their workers so badly? How is it in America that you have less rights than we have here in South Africa under our constitution? The right to be a union member in South Africa is a constitutional right rather than a legislative right like it is here in the United States." So I had to explain to Kaya and to my students there, as I've had to explain, frankly, throughout my life as a trade unionist, why it is that certain things are the way they are. Now, tonight I've been asked to kind of project forward and talk about some of the alternatives, what's the future going to look like. But I want to just give you the figures, and again, Kitty gave you one of them, and I just want to slightly change that. Right now, the overall unionization, union density in the United States stands at a little less than 12%, and that's public and private sector workers. If you go only to private sector workers in the United States, it's a little under 8%. Public sector workers are 37% organized across the United States. They are the backbone of the labor movement. You're going to see why, I think, in a second. As Kitty laid out to you, absolutely true. In 1955, at the time of the merger of the AFL and the CIO, around a little over a third of the nation's workers were covered by unions, at a time when public sector workers were not organized, for the most part. Very few public sector workers in 1955. We've seen a straight decline since 1955 to this day. You can watch the trend line. The trend line has continued down, and we've had some fairly interesting kind of way stations along the way. So, for example, around 1977, 78, 79, for the first time, workers started seeing real regression in their actual standard of living in the United States, which has continued even to this point. You know, we've seen a variety of shocks, as you can imagine. Your grandparents and your parents were used to the concept that there were United Auto Workers who covered automobile industry. In my case, I'm a paper worker, so the paper workers have covered paper mills, steel workers have covered steel mills. And they could see in their town dominant structures, those steel mills, those paper mills, those auto factories, where people worked, where they saw people go back and forth across those gates each day, carrying lunch buckets, and they were actually living the dream because they were able to use the money that they got through unionized wages to send their kids to school, to often take themselves out of a kind of a poverty existence where they weren't sure where the next paycheck was coming from and whether or not they could make it, to the point where they could own homes in America, they could actually have savings and everything else. Now, we've fallen far, okay? And we're at a point, you know, now in 2010, we're at a point where you look forward and say, well, what's going to happen? If you follow that trend line that I was just talking about, the trend line is continuing down. If it continues down, you know, that has some questions that I'll raise in a second. The question is, how do we turn that trend line up? Well, what other kind of alternatives exist for working people? Okay? The traditional unions that we've used in the past have some limitations, and I'm about to explore those with you as we go through this handout. So there are four scenarios I've laid out just for the purpose of discussion. I want to make sure that we have time to open it up so that if any questions you have of the three of us and any points you want to make, we have time to talk about it. So the first thing you have to ask is the future in organizing? If the future is in organizing, what does that mean? So the long ago, the Industrial Workers of the World, which was started in 1905, believed that there should be one big union, that you should not discriminate based on what that man or woman did. that they should all be in one big union, whether they work in an auto plant, whether they be a Teamster, whether or not they work at Walmart, whether or not they work at MSU or wherever. Today, we're seeing that one big union begin to exist, not because of the fact that suddenly we've all woken up saying, isn't, you know, one big union a great idea? It's growth through merger. So that most of the major growth that's happening now in a lot of unions is because of the fact that the size of their internationals, as they're called, like in my case, the paper workers, I saw my union get smaller and smaller until we finally merged into the United Steelworkers, so I'm a steelworker member now rather than a paper worker. Now the reason that that happens is because, just like Kitty said, dues dollars drive the ability to have union staff who speak for the workers, you know, having that international union headquarters like we do in Pittsburgh, like the UAW does in Detroit, having a legal staff, having a health and safety staff, having pension experts and everything else, all of that costs money. And if you can't have enough members, you're going to have to merge. So one trend that's continuing right now and has been going on for a while, and I don't think it's going to abate, is you're going to see more and more of the unions merge. United Auto Workers came to a near merger with the International Association of Machinists and the Steelworkers a few years ago. They all veered away from that merger at that time. At that point, it was a marriage of desire. Mergers are no longer marriages of desire, they're marriages of necessity. So there's a question of whether or not the United Auto Workers will continue to exist within the next 5 to 10 years, or whether it will join my union, the Steelworkers, or some other union, and continue to grow through merger. Now the tipping point problem, as I've laid out here, is how much does density actually matter? And I think you made the argument. The argument is density matters because if you only have 7% organized in the private sector, that means 93% are not organized. Now what does that mean? That means that if you're President Bill Clinton, when you get into office, you do not sign labor law reform. Unfortunately, we couldn't get it through either Clinton's administration, Carter's administration. It looks like we're not going to get it through the Obama administration. He signed the Family Medical Leave Act. Because the Family Medical Leave Act covers all workers. Labor legislation covers unionized workers in the mind of legislators and in the mind of the public. They look at us, labor, as class legislation, that somehow it's about a specific class of individuals setting them aside from other people. So if you're a politician and you're trying to say to yourself, do I please the 7%, or do I please, or say the larger figure, 12%, do I go for the 1 out of 10 workers that are union members, or do I somehow try to appeal to all workers as workers, even if I'm using that kind of language, with something that is going to cover everyone, okay? Now the tipping point problem is, as Kitty laid out, is that progressive social legislation has come out with union backing, okay? So whether it be the child labor legislation, whether it be the 1964 Civil Rights Act, whether it be the FMLA, the reason we have those is because of the fact that organized labor put its shoulder to the political wheel to make such things possible. How are we going to continue to get progressive legislation if we continue to see a downturn in the amount of people that are organized? Very, very important problem. Now, one thing that the argument has been made is what we need to do is we need to organize better. And this comes out of the fact that, frankly, we have not always been as good as organizers within the union movement as we need to be. So over the period, I would say, of the last 20 years, there has been a huge concerted amount of activity to make organizers better at what they do. Now, despite that problem, the legal card deck is stacked against us. So labor law in America actually discourages unions from being organized rather than promoting union organization. So it's a huge problem. Now, the other part of that problem, I am not against individual rights legislation. In fact, I'm very, very pro individual rights legislation. The problem is that starting in 1964 with the Civil Rights Act, the mind of Americans changed. Prior to 1964, if you wanted justice in America, you got yourself a union. After 1964, if you wanted justice in America for yourself, you got a lawyer. There was a shift away from collectivist understanding of how in the world we all gain justice, to move instead to the notion that if you are aggrieved, you should sue. Now the problem is that as much as I'm again for rights legislation, most people in America, if they have a problem at work, use exit voice. That means that they pick up and they go to a new job. They do not necessarily stand and fight where they are if they're an individual worker. Because the fact that there isn't a lot, frankly, there's not a high percentage of success in individually fighting. That's why I believe, and I think a lot of us believe, in unionization. However, exit voice is what most people use. That is, if you have a crappy job at Burger King, you go and get another crappy job at McDonald's. If you're sexually harassed, if you are somehow discriminated against from the boss, and which is, that I think, a very, very unfortunate problem. Now, what we've attempted to do over the period of the last, I would say, 15 years in the labor movement is this notion of organize to bargain and bargain to organize. What that means is this, that you should actually pick targets that you're attempting to organize so that you can strengthen the bargaining that you already have. So that, for example, if you happen to be Eaton Corporation, which has a lot of non-union locations, but many of them under, some under the UAW, it makes a lot of sense to try to organize more Eaton Corporation locations, because it gives more bargaining strength to the UAW members at each of those individual locations. Then what you do is you use the strength of bargaining to try to get neutrality agreements and other things that allow you to organize more. It becomes a very progressive cycle if you're actually able to do it. Unfortunately, the wind has been blowing against that. EFCA, the Employee Free Choice Act, which we've all been trying to get through Congress, actually was very pro the whole notion of card check and being able to use just indication of interest on the part of workers to allow them then to go immediately into bargaining. This has stalled in the Congress, and our possibility probably of getting it out anytime soon is extremely low. Doesn't mean that we shouldn't continue to try, but it's unfortunate that we stalled during the Carter administration with labor law reform in 1978. We stalled in the Clinton administration with anti-scab legislation to stop permanent replacements during that administration, and now, unfortunately, we're stalling on this. Here in America, we have only actually legislatively changed our labor law. We passed it in 35, amended it with some frankly regressive things, including right to work in 1948, changed it again somewhat regressively in 1959, and a slight revision in 1974. We have not seen major revision except through the courts and the board making decisions in labor law really since more like 59, but even going back further, maybe even to 48.